Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming, and on behalf of the whole Department of Nuclear Science and Engineering, and especially the folks here in the front that make the big decisions, I'd like to welcome you all to the 2019 Graduate Expo. So for those of you who are joining us for the first time here at MIT, this expo is designed to showcase a part of the work that you can become a part of, to put it less eloquently than I'd like. Just to give you an idea of some of the things that have happened in the past few years, our researchers have done things like increase the efficiency of quantum detection by a factor of 1,000, designed a new fusion reactor that has a chance of making it on the grid in your lifetime, maybe even my lifetime. And a lot of us are working pretty hard to make that happen, increasing critical heat flux in nuclear reactors, stopping problems like corrosion and fouling once and for all, designing advanced fission and fusion reactors, and working with the public to try to engage them on policy issues and problems of nuclear energy and in getting a more empathetic side to the whole field of nuclear. I hope you'll like what you see today. We've handpicked three folks to give you talks about, give you a little bit of depth into the sort of work that we do here in NSE, as we like to call it. And I think you'll find us to be a pretty fun group. I like to say that we've got our feet on the ground and our heads in the clouds. We are both accessible yet eccentric. And this is the place where Triumph of the Nerds is definitely the modus operandi. You'll find yourself talking about technical things all the time in bars, not because you have to, but because you want to. And we want to convince you to become a part of it. So with that, I'd like to hand it off to our first speaker, who is Sean Ballinger.
Hi, everyone. I don't need this. Hi, everyone. I'm Sean Ballinger. I'm a third-year grad student at the Plasma Science and Fusion Center. And I'm going to talk to you about my research on W7X, which is part of our international collaborations. W7X is a reactor in Germany. So I'd like to thank my advisors, Jim Terry, Ann White, and my many collaborators. So I'm going to start with some background on how fusion works. And fusion was actually discovered by asking how the sun burns. So scientists figured there had to be a way that lighter elements come together and fuse to form heavier nuclei and release energy in the process. So this is one of the reactions that happens in the sun, and it's protons coming together to form a helium-4 nucleus. And fusion could be the best way to make electricity on Earth because the oceans are full of H2O, and that's very easy to convert into deuterium. And deuterium is one of the fuels for the DT reaction, so deuterium and tritium coming together to fuse and form a neutron and a helium-4 nucleus and releasing 18 MeV of energy in the process. So if you're trying to harness energy from this on Earth, you would have your fusion reaction happening inside a confinement chamber to keep it away from the heavy nuclei in the outside atmosphere, relatively heavy, like oxygen or nitrogen. And then your fusion reactions inside this chamber would heat some surrounding material. You would take that thermal energy through a heat exchanger to a steam turbine and create electricity in a very standard way. The problem, though, is that a simple box won't hold your plasma for long enough to produce energy from fusion reactions. So some really exotic conditions are required to get fusion to happen inside a box like this. So you would need temperature of 3 × 10⁸ degrees Kelvin. You need 10^20 particles per meter cubed, confined for 1 second. Or you can play with these parameters, but that's a general thing to aim for. And it's very hard to get all these conditions at the same time. So what will happen in this case is after very little time, your particles will all hit the wall and become cold and stop participating in the fusion reactions. So you could have the idea to use magnetic fields to confine your particles and keep them away from the walls. So particles will gyrate when they're charged around magnetic field lines. And you could use this by wrapping the field lines into a torus shape to keep them away from the walls. Unfortunately, this is an unstable configuration. So very few seconds after, you're going to have your particles hit the wall again and get cold. So the trick here is you actually need to add a twist to the plasma magnetic field. And you do that with a plasma current in the tokamak configuration. And that's the red arrow going through the purple plasma here. And so the outside magnets creates the green line field. And when you add the plasma current, it creates those black field lines. And that is a very stable configuration for the plasma to be in, and that keeps your plasma very happy. But that plasma current can cause instabilities and disruption, and it's hard to maintain it in steady state. So An alternative to the tokamak is the stellarator, where you use just external currents to add this twist to your magnetic field. And when you don't have a plasma current, you avoid many instabilities, and you have very easy steady state operation. But you do have these very complicated magnets, like the turquoise ones out here, that go around your stellarator. And in this case, they're continuous. So they're very difficult to build stellarators. And for that reason, tokamaks have had a bit of a head start on them and have achieved better performance. So this is what it looks like, the tokamak roadmap to fusion. Right now, in the present day, we have fusion science experiments, such as ASX Upgrade and JET in the UK. And these are not producing energy, just we have fusion reactions that happen inside them, and scientists study them. JET has actually come close to producing as much energy with its plasma as you put into it with microwaves or with neutral beams, but not quite there yet. The next step is ITER, really. It's being built in France, and it has the goal of producing more energy with its plasma than you put into it. And then the next step on the ITER path to fusion is DEMO, which you can see is a very large reactor, maybe three elephants tall. And MIT is pursuing a different approach with the SPARC and ARC reactors. So the philosophy there is to produce a much smaller reactor with a high magnetic field that should be more economically attractive. Now, on the stellarator side of things, there have been a number of stellarators. Some of the most important ones are W7AS, LHD, and W7X. W7AS was the precursor to W7X. And LHD is still operating in Japan right now, and W7X is sort of the top-of-the-line stellarator right now. And it's come close to approaching the performance of some of the best tokamaks today. There hasn't been much thought for a burning plasma stellarator experiment, but people have thought a little bit about a stellarator reactor. And you can see there's the massive Helios 5B concept down there. So it shows you there's some room for improvement, at least in making these reactors economically attractive. If we zoom in on the stellarators, this is a view of the magnets and the resulting plasma shapes for different stellarators. So you can see that there's a lot of diversity here. LHD has these continuous coils that go around the stellarator. W7X has many discrete magnets. So there is a very large design space to explore with stellarators. And W7X is a unique stellarator because it has the magnetic island diverter concept. So it takes this inspiration from tokamaks, which have diverters that allow for very good heat exhaust and impurity exhaust from the plasma by sort of separating the core plasma from the wall. And in the case of W7X, these magnetic islands, which are sort of like bubbles in the magnetic field, are what intersect the diverter plates and exhaust heat and impurities from the plasma while keeping the core plasma very well confined. Now, a challenge in tokamaks and stellarators alike is edge turbulence, which degrades confinement and affects wall heat loads. So this is an image from Alcator CMOD, actually, that shows the core plasma leaking heat out of plasma to the wall of Alcator CMOD, and it's doing that across the boundary of the core plasma. So we wanted to investigate what this phenomenon looks like in W7X, and our philosophy here was just very simple, that the edge radiates visible light, and so we're going to watch edge turbulence in W7X using a high-speed camera. So this was our setup. We have the MIT fast camera looking through a fiber bundle, which leads to a little opening in the vessel of W7X that it looks out from. And this is what that view looks like. It's looking down the plasma, basically, and at one of these diverter modules. And this is what it sees. So it sees the plasma intersecting a diverter module, shown in yellow. And there's a video at the right, which is very surprising to us, because even at 10,000 frames per second, we were expecting to see a very stable plasma. And what we did not expect was to see this 1 to 2 kilohertz fluctuation, especially in the diverter area light of the plasma. So we wanted to investigate why that was happening. And we looked for this fluctuation in many other plasma parameters, and we found it in the plasma stored energy, in the plasma density, and the edge density and potential of the plasma. So we also found it in the diverter tile temperatures, which were fluctuating at the same rate. These were measured by an infrared camera, and it was fluctuating with maybe 2.5 degrees out of 600 degrees Celsius. And that may not seem like a big fluctuation, but this was still very interesting to us because we thought with a reactor concept or with, you know, different magnetic fields or plasma conditions, this fluctuation might be of more or less importance, and we wanted to characterize that. So we wanted to first understand why this fluctuation is even occurring. And we're still not quite there yet. We're still investigating why it's happening. But we found that it's occurring at large toroidal currents. So I lied a little bit earlier when I said that stellarators have no toroidal current. They actually do have a naturally arising current that is difficult to suppress entirely, but it's pretty small compared to what you'd find on a tokamak. And you can see on the left, those are the plasma currents for hundreds of shots that I've plotted on top of each other. And the fluctuating shots are shown in orange. It's a little difficult to tell from the raw data there, but when you bin that data in by current, you find that for low values of toroidal current, only about 40% of the shots are fluctuating, whereas at large values of toroidal current, about 70% of them are. So that's what we've figured out so far. With this talk, I've tried to show that it's a little bit of a wild west in the world of in stellarators. There's a lot to discover, and we found this very interesting phenomenon of a 1 kilohertz fluctuation that we verified with other diagnostics, and we're still investigating why it happens. We want to investigate further using the gas puff imaging project that's under construction at MIT. And in this project, we have a capillary tube that puffs some gas at the edge of the plasma, which, when it's ionized, produces a lot of light and lets you see the edge turbulence in detail. So that's a little taste of what's happening at the PSFC. And there are lots of other collaboration projects that are ongoing with different tokamaks around the world. And we hope you'll join.
Thanks a lot, Sean. So I'd like to open it up for a few questions from the audience. Did I see your hand, Dennis? No? OK. So I got one for you.
Yeah.
How much time did it take you between deciding to do this and actually getting it on W7X?
That's a good question. Maybe a year and a half to install the camera there. So it's a pretty big science experiment, and there are a lot of diagnostics. So coordinating things is a bit of a challenge. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it was pretty straightforward. I think Dennis has a question.
So yeah. How come a stellarator, when you showed the different concepts, is so much bigger than a tokamak?
Basically, stellarators require a pretty large aspect ratio compared to tokamaks.
What's that?
So that's just the width of the plasma relative to the, diameter of the big torus. So you can see the demo reactor is much smaller. I don't have a very easy answer for that off the top of my head, but that's where things seem to be going right now in the trend with stellarators.
Got time for, yeah, Cody.
Sean, with the optical diagnostic using, you are doing some sort of line of sight averaging with the camera, right?
There's
a large volume of plasma that you're using.
Right.
How do you sort of spatially correlate where these things are actually? How do you know it's at the diverter plate and not sort of upstream of that in the camera field? Maybe?
Right. I would say that's because we see the edge of the diverter plate. And sure, there is some there is some line averaging happening, and we may be seeing sort of down the length of the diverter. But that fluctuation that we measured was just for a single pixel. So we think a single pixel at the edge of the diverter is not going to have a lot of line averaging effects happening. And we verified that this fluctuation was happening in other diagnostics, which are both line averaged and also kind of more point-like measurements. So it seems to be a global thing.
We've got time for one more question. Well, I got one quick one for you. So you said it's 1.5 to 2 years between conception and installation.
Mm-hmm.
That's well within the frame of a PhD, but it's still a pretty long time.
Yeah.
So what sort of opportunities do you have to get your work out there before the camera's installed and you start getting data? For publication, for presentation, I mean, what's it like to, do you get a chance to tell people about what you're doing before it's done?
Yeah, before that, I was actually looking at data from Alcator CMOD. So we had this camera installed on Alcator CMOD previously, and it was sort of doing the same thing, looking at edge turbulence. And so there was data to analyze there while the camera was being built for W7X. And I also helped out with putting the camera together and putting it on W7X. I've been there during the summers to operate the camera as well. So I've had that opportunity.
Nice. Okay, let's thank Sean once again.
Thank you.